研院也是做现在讲师，都是教这个 technique writing， 所以他对我们这个学术写作哈，其实是台湾人常犯的一些错误，很非常的了解。那再来就是后来他也是有上一系列的课程，那今天我们特别请他来帮我们讲，就是有关怎么做 conference 的 presentation 哈。因为我们主要现在反而是我们物理治疗系哈，都有这个就是 seminar， 就是 graduate student 的 seminar， 那我们要求 student 都要用 English 做 presentation， 那希望他们出去做 conference 啊，或是不管任何的 formal 的 presentation， 可能有一个比较好的训练。所以今天很有幸请到好 Mr. Wallace 来帮我们做这个题目的这个解讲一下这个技巧还有重点在哪里。那在外面要听这个 Steve 的课哈，要花不少钱哈，所以我们今天很荣幸可以把他请到台大医学院来做这样演讲，那很欢迎大家来聆听，那就我们掌声来欢迎 Mr. Steve。
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. It's good to be here this morning at your lovely school and see all of your bright, happy, smiley faces. This is great.I always have the morning class in Chowda, and my students come in and they look so sleepy. So sleepy. So the first thing I do is turn the air conditioning very cold. When you're really cold, you can't sleep. You know? And today it's already cold in this room, which is good. Cold is the teacher's best friend. And today I'm here to talk about presenting at conferences. This is a class that I usually teach for an entire semester.In Zhongyang and in Chowda. I have 12 hours a week now teaching this class. And my students are usually PhD students who must go to a conference and present, but they are very worried, you know. They are very afraid of speaking in public. And today I want to just give you an overview about conference presentations, and I want to share with you too some ways that you can gain confidence.For your first conference presentation, or your second, if that's your second one. But I believe that this is Han Zhong Yao, because people don't appreciate what you do until you speak about it, or until you write about it. These are the vital skills that we need in every domain. Doesn't matter what we do in the laboratory, if we never tell anybody,How will they know? How will they appreciate our contribution? So technical writing and public speaking, these are the two things that I teach. And I teach in the engineering school to those students who really need it very, very much. But it applies equally to you in medicine as well. You also must share your results. You also must write and talk about what you have done to be appreciated for it. And I want to begin with this idea that I just introduced, thatThe person who presents the research will get the credit for the research. An example of this is Paul Chu. He is credited as being the first person to have a semiconductor with a boiling point above liquid nitrogen. You know, Paul Chu was not the main researcher. The two researchers were Jim Ashburn and Ma Kuan Wu. But they asked Paul Chu to present because his presentation skill was very good.And even though Paul Chu said, these are the real researchers, no one remembers them today. Because he was the presenter. The presenter is the best. Another example here, Jen Sheng, postdoctoral researcher, discovered another superconductor at an even higher temperature. But because he was not a good speaker, because English was not his first language,The department chair, Alan Herman, spoke at the press conference. Even though Herman told everyone that this guy was the real researcher, no one remembers him. Alan Herman is the one who gets the credit. We cannot afford to not speak well. It's vital to gain appreciation for what we have done and for our ideas. Now, you have all probably seen bad conference presentations. I have seen too many because I always go and watch my students when they present at conferences. And I recently was at a conference and saw kind of the classic bad example. The student got up, went to the front, sat down, opened his paper, started to read in a low dead voice. As I watched him, 20 people in the front stood up and walked out. And when the student looked up, it was empty. I mean, it was just me and a couple other people. People don't have patience for this today. They don't have time for it. They are busy, and especially at a conference with several sessions. If they think this one's boring, they're gone. Our first job is to keep the people there. Our second job, don't let people go to sleep. That is so important, because if people are sleeping, doesn't matter what you say, they're sleeping. We have got to make sure that we are being interesting and being informative. Interesting too, very critical here. Oh, regarding this speech that I just was telling you about, the student kept talking. He didn't plan well for his conference time. He spent, 10 minutes talking about the literature review in a 12-minute presentation. So finally, the speaker's, the chair said, "You're finished." And he's like, "I'm finished?" And the time over. He didn't even get a chance to talk about any of his results. He went all the way to the conference to talk for 10 minutes about other people's research. And then briefly at the end started rushing through his own, flipping through slides at crazy speeds that no one could understand. Finally left, complete failure. We have got to have a plan, and we have got to be prepared if we're going to make a good impact with our conference talk. An effective conference talk needs to do two things. Persuade your audience with evidence and be interesting and entertaining. I say both of these because it's not enough to give evidence to a sleeping audience, right? It's like talking to a hotel. There are people sleeping all over the place and nothing is getting across to them. We also have to keep them awake. So we should talk instead of reading. Stand up instead of sitting down. Move around instead of staying in the same place. Make eye contact with your audience. Don't look at only one side of the room, look at both sides. Students always complain about this to me. They say, "Teacher, I'm scared at looking people in the eye." Especially because some people, they don't look like nice people. Their faces are just so mean, and I don't want to look at them. And so I tell them, "Well, then don't look at that guy. You know, just put a block on him." Find 3 happy faces in your audience. It may be difficult, but it's possible. Yeah, hopefully, they're in different places. So you find a happy face over here. Lady in the orange, she looks very friendly, okay? We look at her, and then we look at the lady in the blue. She looks like a sweet lady, okay, over here. And then we look at the tall guy in the red, okay? So you just keep looking back and forth between your 3 happy faces. It gives the feeling you're looking at everybody. And don't look at those people who are taking your energy away. That have the ugly faces and just keep looking back at you. Look at the positive people. And finally, imitate good speakers. When you go to the conference next time, watch the conference presenters. Find the ones where people are awake. Find the ones that are interesting and steal all their ideas. Copy everything, especially in your own domain. You know, you're in medicine, find a good medical speaker, copy him. Don't copy the politicians on TV, that's a different, different style. Different style, but find someone who's related to your domain and observe the audience reaction. Look around you, see if people are sleeping or not. If they're not sleeping, start taking notes. What is he doing? What can we copy? What can we steal in our own presentation to improve? Now, why do sometimes very smart people give such poor talks? Well, it's a reaction to fear. Psychologists tell us that we are naturally afraid of being away from the group because when we are, you can see my flaw and my fault and my problem and judge me and criticize me. So naturally, we don't want to put ourselves in that position. We want to be part of the group, to match in. Biologists tell us that in nature, if an animal goes by himself, he is eaten quickly. If he's part of the group, he can survive longer. So there is a very natural fear, biological fear and psychological fear, of being alone by ourselves in front of people. So we need a good reason, a strong motivation to overcome this fear, and I already mentioned that motivation. It's the one that presents the research gets the credit. That's what our motivation is. I want to talk about a couple of Nobel Prize winners, and I want to contrast their speaking style with you briefly this morning. The first one is Bohr, physicist, and then Volhard, geneticist. Both of them won the Nobel Prize for their contributions. Both of them were ESL learners. They were not English as a first language speakers. Bohr was famous for being boring. he has a reputation. I mean, in his day, nobody could listen to him. Even Einstein didn't like listening to him, and we'll hear a quote from Einstein in a moment. By the way, Einstein was a wonderful speaker. Very, very interesting, very entertaining. Everyone loved Einstein. There's a story of when he went to Japan. He talked for 2.5 hours, and then he quit, and the Japanese were so disappointed he didn't go for 4 hours. How often does that happen, that a scientific presenter wants them to go more? Usually we are happy it's over, but not with Einstein. He was a fantastic speaker. He was a showman, you know, the hair, everything. He really knew how to get the audience's attention. He was a wonderful presenter. Now, Bohr had a really hard time. Here are a couple of scientists talking about Bohr's speaking style, and then I'm going to show you his Nobel Prize speech. Whereas Einstein tried to grasp the hidden essence, disregarding everything he thought irrelevant or not related, Bohr insisted that nothing be left out. So Bohr wanted to include every painful detail, which means that people gave up quickly. Einstein tried to ignore all the details and only focused on the key point. Made him a great speaker. Here's another quote on Bohr. Bohr was much worse. His failing was that he used too many words to express any idea. Wandering about as he spoke, often inaudibly. It means can't hear him. So here he is talking to himself. The audience just gives up. They can't understand him. It's very hard. There's a story. After World War II, Bohr went to Winston Churchill and tried to convince him. Winston Churchill was the Prime Minister of England. Tried to convince Churchill to sign an agreement to stop making nuclear weapons. Bohr was very concerned that the world would start producing a lot of nuclear weapons, and England was the only one that was stopping him from his contract, from getting everyone to agree. So Bohr went in to talk to Churchill, and he started his presentation. After 3 minutes, Churchill said, "I cannot handle it. Please, get out, out." And he kicked Bohr out. Bohr could not keep Churchill's attention to make his key point. And of course, history is different as a result of that. We did not get the no atomic bomb contract signed. We have a lot of bombs around the world today. Could have been different if he'd been a better speaker, if his heart was in the right place, but he just didn't have the speaking ability, and Churchill also had no patience for this kind of slow, bad style. The other one I want to show you is Volhard. Volhard, even though she also was an ESL, second language learner, she used very simple speech, simple sentences, and that is a key point here. This is a very key point for conferences. When we are speaking, we are not trying to show off to our audience the big vocabulary that we know. We are not using big words to impress people. We are trying to express our meaning. Different motivation. Not impress, express. And that makes speaking different from writing, because when I write a big word, someone can get a dictionary and see the meaning of my word. But when I use a big word in speaking, you can't get a dictionary and look it up. And when you are trying to think, what does the word mean, you miss the whole point of my sentence. I lose you because I'm trying to impress you. So we want to be simple. We want to use short, simple words. And we don't want to use too many words. Never use two words when you can use one. Never use a long word when you can use a short word. We are emphasizing expressing our meaning, not impressing the audience, and this is particularly important. When we are at an international conference, where not everyone had the same English teacher we had, Some people are from Korea, Japan, India, all over the world. And when you use a big word, maybe they do not understand, very likely that they don't know. So again, don't use big words. Sometimes students do this all the time. They're preparing their speech. They don't know the meaning of a word. So they type the English word into the English-Chinese dictionary. And they get several English words, short, longer, longer, really long. And they copy and paste the really long one in. And I say, why? What does that mean? And they say, I don't know, but it's high class. And I tell them, don't worry about your class. Worry about the meaning. Express the meaning. And this was Bohr's problem, and I don't want that to be yours as well. We'll take a look here at his speech in a moment. Here's George Bohr's Nobel Prize acceptance speech. I'm going to give you the first few sentences. Well, this is one sentence here, actually. He begins, "Today, as a consequence of the great honor of the Swedish Academy of Sciences has done me in awarding me this year's Nobel Prize for Physics for my work on the structure of the atom, it is my duty to give an account of the results of this work, and I think that I shall be acting in accordance with the traditions of the Nobel Foundation if I give this report in the form of a survey of the development which has taken place in the last few years within the field of physics to which this work belongs." It's really long and just complicated, hard to catch it. And this is to a very general audience. I mean, Nobel Prize speech. Here's his second speech. The second two sentences. "The present state of atomic theory is characterized by the fact that we do not believe, only believe of the existence of atoms to be proved beyond a doubt, but also we even believe that we have an intimate knowledge of the constituents of the individual atoms." Oh. Here's the next sentence. "I cannot at this occasion give a survey of the scientific developments that have led to this result." And he says, "I cannot give a survey," but then he gives a survey. "I will only recall the discovery of the electron toward the close of the last century, which furnished the final verification and led to the conclusive formulation of the conception of the atomic nature of Wallace's hope." He loves nouns, noun, 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 and it makes it so hard. There's no verbs in his sentence. "Since the discovery by Faraday of the fundamental laws of electrochemical theory and its greatest triumph in the electronic disassociation theory of Archimedes." Wow. Complicated, long sentences. By the way, Faraday was a wonderful speaker as well. I don't have quotes from him here, but he was a great, simple, strong speaker. Let's contrast Bohr's speech with Volhard. Well, here's Einstein talking about Bohr. He said, "Bohr states his opinion like one perpetually groping, like trying to feel, and never like one who believes himself to be in possession of definite truth." Einstein says he's not sure of himself. He always talks like he doesn't know what he's really saying. Here's another someone comparing Einstein and Bohr, another scientist. He says, whereas Einstein tried to... Okay, I already did this one. Next one. Here's Bohr's Nobel Prize speech. I want you to notice how she uses simple sentences, how some of her sentences go specific for the specific for the specialized audience, but other sentences are general so that everyone can understand. And this is a very important concept in scientific presentations. Our audience is mixed. Some people are specialists in our domain. Some are specialists in the general domain, and some are not specialists at all. How can we give information that is interesting to all of them? Well, we will frequently dip in and out, from specialized to general. We will tell some special knowledge and then say why it's important to a general audience. We'll give implications that everyone can understand. We'll introduce the problem in a way everyone can understand. And yet, we also dip into some specific terminology when we need to. And that's what she does so well here in her Nobel speech. Let's take a look at what she does. "In the life of animals, complex forms alternate with simple ones." That's nice, short, strong sentence in the beginning. "An individual develops from a single one-celled egg that bears no resemblance on the complex structure and pattern displayed in the juvenile and adult form. The process of embryonic development, with its highly ordered increase in complexity, accompanied by perfect reproducibility, is controlled by a subset of the animal genes. Animals have a large number of genes." Notice that, short sentence. The exact number is not known for any multicellular organism, nor is it known how many and which are required for the development of complexity, pattern, and shape during embryogenesis. Now, here's her only technical word so far, embryogenesis. But, I mean, we can probably guess what that means, even if we're not in her area. We know embryo, we know genesis means beginning. We're pretty sure what that means. To identify these genes and to understand their functions is a major issue in biological research. Isn't that a great beginning sentence? Even if I'm not from her domain, I can appreciate what she has done. Because she gives me some simple sentences, but also she talks to the specialist as well, at the same time telling him what her contribution is. Here are some very successful scientific presenters, famous for being very interesting, almost showmen. From a very young age, they were natural, even though many of them were not first language speakers. Here are people who became very strong later in their careers. They started out being very weak speakers, very poor, but they consciously tried to become better. They consciously developed their speaking skill, and they talk about it at great length in their books. And here is finally one who was always very, very shy her whole life, extremely terrified of people, and yet overcame that to become a wonderful speaker, Marie Curie. You know, there's a story about Marie Curie. Even after 20 years of being a professor, after 20 years, on the day she would have to do class, her daughter would say she would wake up early in the morning and start walking around nervously. She would go to her room, close the door. She would become very nervous 1 hour before her talk, which was in the evening. And just before she walked out, she would be sweating, shaking very badly. She would walk out in front of her class. Her students loved her. She only had 20 students. When she came out, all the students would rise in respect because she won the Nobel Prize. She was a great scientist. You know, they would all rise, and then they would sit down, and she would begin to talk. But she spoke very well. She overcame it. She was a very interesting teacher, but never overcame the fear. Was always terrified of speaking in public, and yet was a great scientific presenter. Here's Michael Faraday on presenting. He says, lectures depend entirely for their value on the manner in which they are given. It is not the matter, not the subject so much as the man. He's emphasizing that in scientific presentation, it's not enough to only have good results. We have to present those results well if we want our audience to see and appreciate our value, our contribution. Other scientists used analogies, examples, and stories. Otto Frisch, when he's describing the size of a nucleus, said, if an atom were enlarged to the size of a bus, the nucleus would be like the dot on this eye. You know, he liked to use analogies, stories. Einstein used to talk about shooting sparrows in the dark to describe the likelihood of producing nuclear energy. Fred Soschkin, when describing his work on turbine blades, said the amount of power produced by a single gas turbine blade equals that of a Maserati sports car. They tried to make their language easy for the common person to understand, easy for the student to understand. They used analogies and examples that would be appreciated by their audience. Here's a scientist, a famous writer, on Linus Pauling, another Nobel Prize winner. He says, on March 21, I attended a lecture given by Linus Pauling. This talk was the best talk by anyone on any subject that I have ever heard. The talk was more than a talk to me. It filled me with a desire of my own to become a speaker. This is the young scientist who, of course, later wrote more books than any other scientific scholar. Here's another James Watson talking about Pauling's presentations. Again, Linus Pauling. He said, Pauling's talk was made with his usual dramatic flair. The words came out as if he had been in show business his whole life. A curtain kept his model hidden until near the end of his lecture, when he proudly unveiled his latest creation. Then, with eyes twinkling, fire in his eyes, Linus explained the specific characteristics that made his model, the helix, uniquely beautiful. Even if he were to say nonsense, his mesmerized students would never know because of his unquenchable self-confidence. So here is a Nobel Prize winner and a showman. Robert Feynman, great physicist. His lectures were so popular on physics that professors from his faculty, his own faculty there at Berkeley, would pack his lecture hall. There was no room for his students because the other teachers loved his lectures so much. He was just a wonderful speaker at explaining very complicated concepts in a simple way. Feynman absolutely riveted the attention of everyone in the room for the entire time he was there. His need to do that explains some of the racy stories he used to tell about himself, but it lies close to the core of what made him a great teacher. For Feynman, the lecture hall was a theater, and the lecturer a performer, responsible for providing drama and fireworks, as well as facts and figures. This was true regardless of his audience, whether he was talking to undergraduates or graduate students, to his lecture colleagues, or the general public. My point in giving you all these stories is not that we have to give fireworks and be like showmen, but we do need to be conscious and aware of the impact we are having on our audience. Great scientists understand that great science is only appreciated when it's the impact we are having on our audience. Great scientists understand that great science is only appreciated when it's presented well. And that's why I want to remind you of all of these Nobel Prize winners who spent so much time on learning to speak well in public so that their ideas and concepts would be appreciated. And in fact, maybe that's why their ideas were appreciated, because they took this time to learn how to present their science well. Here's another professor there at Berkeley who was talking about Feynman. But even when he thought he was explaining things to freshmen and sophomores, it was not always really they who benefited most from what he was doing. It was more often us, scientists, physicists, and professors, who would be the main beneficiaries of his magnificent achievement, which was nothing less than to see all of physics with fresh eyes. Lots of other scientists and teachers watched his lectures. Oppenheimer is another great example of a scientific presenter, because Oppenheimer, again, the atomic bomb, right? Three times nominated for the Nobel Prize. Oppenheimer, in his early career, was a terrible, terrible speaker. When he first began teaching at Berkeley in 29, he had 60 students join his class, and at the end of the semester, only one survived. Only one was still in his class. He was just an awful speaker. He didn't seem to be able to communicate well or his research well, but the special thing about Oppenheimer is that he went ahead and he tried very hard to learn his presentation skill. Here's his friend talking about him and his development of his speaking. He said, "Desperately eager to reach his students, his sensitivity sharpened by his own past difficulties, Oppenheimer made it a point to pay as much attention to the trouble of his charges as to the intricacies of his subject. His language evolved into an oddly eloquent mix of erudite phrases and pithy slang, and he learned to exploit the extraordinary talent for elucidating complex technical matters." He would take his very technical issue and he would use the very common language to explain it. He could explain it very simply. He didn't use the big vocabulary, and that was his power. That was his strength. That was his special ability. The result of his practice, later students found him the most stimulating lecturer they had experienced. He became extremely popular as a result of his changing his style and structure. Here's a Nobel Prize winner about Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer was Hans Bethe's teacher. He says, "Probably the most important ingredient Oppenheimer brought to his teaching was his exquisite taste. He always knew what were the important problems, as shown in his choice of subjects. He truly lived with these problems, struggling for a solution, and he communicated his concern to the group." Here's another Nobel Prize winner on her teacher, Ludwig Boltzmann, who was the developer of the statistical treatment of atoms. She talked about Boltzmann at the end of her life. When she was retiring, she talked about the most important contributors to her thought. This is what she had to say. "Boltzmann had no inhibitions whatsoever about showing his enthusiasm when he spoke, and this naturally carried his listeners along. He was fond of introducing remarks of an entirely personal character. So he would introduce personal things about himself into his lecture. I particularly remember how, in describing the kinetic theory of gases, he told us how much difficulty and opposition he had encountered because he had been convinced of the real existence of atoms, and how he had been attacked from the philosophical side without always understanding what the philosophers had against him. She remembers the story that Boltzmann told him. Here's another, she says, Boltzmann was the most beautiful and stimulating thing I have ever heard. He was so enthusiastic about everything he taught us that one left every lecture with the feeling of a completely new and wonderful world had been revealed. I already told you here about Eve Curry and her mother. This is her quote about her mother's continual shyness and how she was never able to get over it. Well, that's an introduction to researchers who have taken presentations seriously. Let's get practical for a moment. I want to introduce to you 10 ways that you can gain more confidence, like Boltzmann, for your next conference presentation. And these have worked very well for my students, they've worked well for me, and I want to share them with you again as well. First, expect to be nervous. In fact, a little nervousness is good. If you have absolutely no nervousness, then you have no energy. So a bit of nervousness can help actually make you a better speaker, as long as it doesn't overcome you, doesn't overpower you. Second, prepare. And when I say prepare, I mean don't write down every word that you're going to say and read it 500 times and put it in your mind exactly memorized. That is the recipe for disaster. Recipe for disaster. You know why? Because you have the whole thing in your mind, and what happens when you forget one word? It's all gone. It disappears. What happens when someone raises their hand? Question. All gone. You don't have a way to bring it back. It's not safe. Have an outline. An outline are simple words, maybe letters, phrases that you can look at in an emergency and memorize the outline, 5 points, 6 points, and then have an example for each point or have key points under that, but keep those in your mind. Don't depend on a memorized speech. Also, it wastes a lot of time to write that kind of speech because you are wasting more time reading the speech than preparing the content for the speech, and it's not sustainable. You can't do this every time. You don't have time every time to memorize, especially a longer speech. Practice. Every chance you get, practice. And the example I like to give here is our American president, Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln, you know Lincoln?
Yes.
Most famous American president. If you ask 100 Americans, who is your favorite president, over 80% will say Lincoln. Washington, Jefferson, Kennedy, all the rest are 20. Lincoln is like a god. We love Lincoln. He was our American president during the Second World War. We don't learn any other president's speech except his. We memorize Lincoln's speeches. We think he's our best public speaker. Now, Lincoln began with some very serious disadvantages, and his biggest disadvantage was the fact that he was born with a disease that made his bones very long. They kept going longer and longer, they were soft, and his rib cage actually would curl and made his lungs smaller. This is why he was so tall. This bone disease also made his body misshaped. One side of his face was much higher than the other. And when we see pictures of Lincoln today, the artist was being very kind. Because in reality, he was a very ugly man, by all accounts. Now, because his lungs were small, and because he couldn't stand straight, he had a very high voice, like a girl, long bony fingers. He was born in great poverty, a one-room house, dirt floor. His mother died when he was young, and he was a farm boy working in Illinois. But he decided at a young age he wanted to read, so he found an old copy of the Bible and taught himself to read by candlelight after work every night. He wanted to be a speaker, so he went to the local church and asked the musher, the minister, if he could speak on Sundays. And the minister said, I don't know. I don't know if that's a good idea. And Lincoln said, please, let me do something. I want to practice my speaking. And finally, the minister said, okay, you can read from the Bible. You know, that seems safe. So Lincoln came to church. He read from the Bible on Sunday in his high voice, and the people in the church told the minister, please don't do that. I mean, one time is okay, second time is just painful. We can't take it. So Lincoln was kicked out of his job reading the Bible. So what was Lincoln going to do? He knew he needed to practice, but how can he practice with no people? He went back to his farm, and every night after work, he would practice his presentation to the corn. You me. Practice his presentation to the corn. If you were driving through American countryside a couple hundred years ago, and you heard a high voice coming from the corn, that was our future most famous American president practicing his presentation skill. Now, if Lincoln can do it, so can you. You don't have corn in Taiwan. But you have rice. I see rice everywhere. In Hsinchu, next to my house, there's like a little rice paddy, and I see the little guy with the cool hat who's working. You can use the, he will not mind. Not mind. You can practice your presentation skill to the rice. Practice every chance you get. I remember when I first wanted to learn how to speak in public, I was in university, and every time the teacher would ask a question, I would force myself to raise my hand, even if I didn't know the answer, to practice my speaking. If the teacher wanted a volunteer to talk, I would volunteer. I put myself in a position where I had to talk, and of course, practice makes perfect, doesn't it? Practice makes perfect. Breathe from your stomach here, not from your throat. Push your diaphragm. This is a medical group, you know what that means. Push it out. Focus on, rehearse. Practice when you're in front of the mirror. Practice when you are driving your motorcycle. Don't practice on the motorcycle. That's dangerous. Dangerous. Practice when it's reasonable, with your friends, before you speak. Focus on your audience. Know what their level is. Have some information, not only for the specialist, but also the more general practitioner in your domain. Don't make him go to sleep wishing there was something for him. Make sure the introduction of the problem is something he understands. And then the implications and applications at the end apply to him. Now, maybe in the middle you will lose him for a while, but at least at the beginning and the end, help him understand the problem and your solution and why it's important. Simplify. Remember, we don't want to impress people with our big vocabulary. We want to express our meaning. Another thing regarding English is really move your mouth a lot. I get students who are always talking, they're mumbling.
Hello, my name is John. I'm
just, it's so hard to catch. If you're speaking English well, you should look a little bit ugly. You should not be beautiful. Really move it. Every sound is important. Particularly because English has so many words that sound similar that if you say a word slightly different, it has an entirely different meaning. So make sure that you're really pronouncing clearly and carefully. Picture success. You know, so many students before their conference presentation, they imagine everything that can go wrong. They think, I'm going to go up there, and I'm going to forget what to say, and someone will start laughing at me, and then someone will throw tomatoes at my head, and it will be a disaster. But this thought is weakening them. This thought is taking away their confidence. We need to think positively. We need to imagine our crowd happy and enjoying what we say, and listening and understanding. That thought is giving us more confidence. That thought is strengthening us. We practice here before we go and do it for real. Good example of this is Tiger Woods, who's having some problems right now. When you watch Tiger Woods play next time, watch him. He takes his golf club, and he looks at the ball, looks at the hole. Buy this speaker for this subject. Those three links must be made. We get two things by doing that, credibility and goodwill. Those are both vital. They have to think we can talk about it, and they have to like us. If they don't like us, even if we are right, they don't care. They ignore us. And at the same time, it's not enough to like us. We also have to believe that we know what we're talking about. That's why those three connections need to be made. Audience, speaker, and subject. And then, and this is probably the most important, pretend to be confident. Ah, this helps students more than any other thing. I want to talk about this for a few minutes. Pretend to be confident. You know, there's an interesting connection between our mind and our body, between our feeling and our action. Professor William James, 1893, behavioral modification theory, still fundamental to psychology. Basically, what Professor James discovered is that we know my feeling will influence my action. For example, if I see a hungry bear, I will feel afraid. My body will shake, right? This is a connection. However, what Professor James discovered is that not only does the feeling influence the action, but by my action can also indirectly control my feeling. By controlling my action, I can change my feeling to match. We can pretend and indirectly control my feeling. By controlling my action, I can change my feeling to match. We can pretend until we become reality. In English, we say, fake it till you make it, right? When we pretend, it happens. So this is fundamental. If we want to be brave, what should we do? Pretend we are already brave and fool ourselves, fool our mind into becoming brave. It happens every time. It's amazing. You come up, you feel terrified, but you pull yourself up. You look at people, you pretend that everyone owes you money. And what happens? The confidence comes. The bravery returns. By pretending, it becomes a reality. I remember when I was a kid, I was reading a story about a pirate. A pirate is the haidao. One eye. Gun. No leg. A pirate. It was actually about a little boy on a pirate ship. And this little boy would watch the pirates do the pirate things. Steal gold, fighting. And the little boy was always afraid when there was a fight because he didn't want to die, so he would run and hide and watch. Well, one day the little boy walked up to the biggest, toughest pirate. This guy was huge, you know. Long hair, big shoulders, no neck. And the little boy pulled on his coat and said, "Excuse me, sir?" And the pirate looked down and said, "What?" He said, "Excuse me, sir, how can I be brave like you? When there's a fight, you run into the fight swinging your sword. You have no fear. I run, I hide, I watch. Tell me your secret." And the pirate said, "Let me tell you the secret." He says, "Remember that in the beginning of the fight, we are all afraid. But when we feel afraid, we pull out our swords, shout loudly, then we lose our fear, and we become brave men." Interesting, isn't it? What happens first? Fear. Then what? Brave action. Then what? Losing the fear. And that is, it can be our experience as well. By pretending we are already confident, the confidence will come. The confidence will come. It happens every week in my public speaking classes. PhD students, nervous, terrified, fool me and fool themselves by pretending that they are already confident. Let me talk just quickly about some advantages and disadvantages of different sources of speech. We've talked a little bit about preparing. What we have four choices when we are preparing. We can speak from points, we can memorize, we can read, or we can speak with no preparation at all. Let's take a look at some of the advantages and disadvantages of each of these types of preparation. If we speak from an outline or from points, we get credibility. We get ease of adjusting the speech. It's easy to modify, easy to change. If the speech to audience is different than you expected, well, you have flexibility to change. You can maintain eye contact, and you can have a natural pace. Disadvantages is your wording will not be perfect, and students always worry about that. I want my wording to be perfect. You know what I find? When their wording is imperfect, it's much easier to understand. Perfect. The natural approach is far easier for the audience to catch. Memorizing. What are the advantages? Precision. You can be exact. Smooth delivery. You have credibility. Eye contact, if you can remember. Disadvantages, potential for disaster. That if you forget one word, it's all gone. Someone raises their hand, gone. And then you have to pull out your notes and try to find your place. Unnatural pace. You can't control the pace, you only know one pace. Inability to adjust the speech. If you come in and the audience is different from what you expected, can you change? No, you just have one. Long preparation time. Reading advantage, precision and smooth delivery. Disadvantage, the credibility is undercut. People don't know if you know what you're talking about. You're only reading something. Anyone can read. Most people can read. Lack of eye contact, unnatural pace. You can't adjust the speech. And also long preparation time because you write every word so carefully and look up every word in the dictionary. Speaking with no notes, no outline. Advantages, no preparation time, eye contact, natural pace. Disadvantages, potential for disaster too. What if you can think of nothing, right? So our ideal choice is speaking from points, using an outline. Well, let me back up a bit. There are times for all of these. Speaking from points is good for the conference presentation. It's good for presentation at business meeting or university lecture. If you want to memorize, this is good for the first few words of the presentation. In fact, I have students memorize their first three sentences just so that that's always good, always smooth. And maybe the ending too. Just because that the beginning and the end are the most important part of the speech. Usually people remember what happens first and last, and in the middle, nothing. Right? So we want to make sure that beginning and end are the best. Short introduction of a speaker, that would be a good place to memorize. Reading, press conference, quotation, I was reading you the quotes today off of my PowerPoint. Complex wording within a presentation. Speaking off the cuff, if you're answering a question or asking a question, this is when you speak with no notes at all. And we talk a lot in my class about answering Q&A. We practice and practice and practice because really, even though we speak with no outline, answering questions is a skill we can learn. It is a skill we can get better at. It is a skill we can get more comfortable with through practice. Let's talk about our voice for a moment. We can change our voice to make our voice more interesting. And I want to emphasize this because when we are communicating, we have four channels of communication. I won't get into them in detail today. But the first one we've already talked about, the words we use. Simple and short is better. Second, the oral channel, which is the way I say my words. Then we have the visual channel, body language, pictorial channel, what I show, the picture that I show for. Now, what's interesting to note is the words we say is only 7% of our total message. That means 93% is not our words, but our body language and the way we say our words and the pictures we show. That's good news for those of us who are ESL learners. Even though our English may be low, we can still be great speakers if we use our other three channels well. This oral channel here can be modified in three ways. I can change my speed, my tone, my volume. I have a student right now in my Tsinghua class. It's last semester. His name is Dim Sum. I know, it's a strange name. I think that's a food. I don't know why. Anyway, his name is Dim Sum. He's an engineering student. And he is a very interesting speaker. And I always don't know why he's such a good speaker, because his English is so poor. Every time he talks, I always think, why is this so good? His English is horrible. But let me just, he uses his other channels so well. And he's so confident. Again, I don't know why he's so confident. His English is bad. But it's okay. Every time Dim Sum will talk, it's a strange situation because the room will become very quiet. There may be great speakers, good English before, but people might be just kind of casually listening. But when Dim Sum comes up, he's kind of tall and very thin, and he has hair that goes straight up like this. And he comes up, and he always walks slowly, and then he pauses and looks at the audience, kind of sad. And he never begins right away, he always pauses. And then he begins very dramatically. He told a story, I remember the story. He began a story like this. He says, long, long time before. Little boy, little girl lived together on an island. Little boy love little girl. Little girl no love little boy.
That's a great story. I still remember it.
Poor English, but really strong channels of communication. We should consider how we can do that in our own speaking as well. It's not only the words we use, but how we say the words. Let's talk about speed. You can speak quickly, or you can slow down, or even stop for a while and continue. In fact, this is the best way to get people's attention. Don't talk louder, just stop talking. People wake up. They say, why isn't he talking? It's a great way to get your audience's attention and bring the inner tone. We can speak in a high tone, or we can speak low. I can't speak as low as my grandfather. You know, my grandfather has this wonderful low voice. The earth will shake a little bit. It's so great. When I get to be 70, 80, I'm sure I will also have that. I'm waiting for that time. But a good speaker will use the full range of his voice. High to low, to high to low. What does high tone indicate? High tone indicates emotion and feeling, high intensity. When we want to get our audience's emotion, we use the higher tone. Martin Luther King Jr., you know, the famous speech, I Have a Dream. I use that speech in my class. I don't have it today. But what's so interesting about that presentation is that it's so high, amazingly high. I have a dream that one day and the crowd is just going crazy. The emotion is so high. And of course, that is his goal in his presentation. And at the same time, what does the low tone mean? The low tone means authority and power. This is true. People don't doubt the low tone. People believe low tone. So when you're giving your results, your data, lower your voice. These are my results. I have a student who always does the opposite, though. He goes, these are my results. He looks like he's doubting himself. He looks like he doesn't trust his own results, so I don't trust them either. You see this on the television, you know? This is CNN, okay. But if they say, this is CNN, you wouldn't believe it. Is it really CNN? Don't let your voice kill your key point, especially at the end of the sentence. Lower the tone at the end to make people believe you more. Now, a good speaker, we use a full range of our voice, high to low, to high to low. Whatever we do, we don't want to just speak in one tone, you know, monotone. Hello, my name is Steve, and now you're getting very sleepy. Eyes are closing. That monotone puts people into a trance, puts them to sleep. Avoid the single tone. Use a full range. Finally, volume. We can speak loudly or softly. And sometimes, speaking in a whisper is a good way to catch people's attention. People think, why is he whispering? What is he saying? Good way to get the attention again. Use a quiet voice, especially for a key point. That's how we can change our voice to make it more interesting as well. I'm due for a break, and I learned a long time ago if people go over 1 hour, they will sleep like babies. So I don't want you to sleep. Let's take 10 minutes, come back cheerful, happy, and full of sunshine, and we will finish up with our time together. 10-minute break. 好, we're going to go ahead and get started here with our last bit of the time together. Next point, when we're speaking, we need to face the audience and speak clearly, as we said, very important, particularly when the size is big. And let me make another comment here. In my experience, Taiwanese students are too quiet. Can't hear them. They may have wonderful things to say, but it's like they're talking to themselves. I just can't hear them. Better. Louder is better. Too loud is better than too soft. At least people can understand you. Another key point is sometimes students think, my English is poor, so I'm embarrassed, so I will speak in a low voice. The problem is if you have bad English and your voice is low, it's impossible. If your English is poor, be louder. At least we can have bad English and your voice is low, it's impossible. If your English is poor, be louder. At least we can guess. At least we have a chance to try to understand. You should not be quieter if your English is worse. You should be louder. You should be louder. Think about your presentation goals. When your audience leaves your speech, you want them to have a clear picture of your contribution, and you want them to read your paper. In fact, we could say that's why you're at the conference, to advertise, just like a dirty salesman. You're there to advertise. I'm a dirty salesman, I can say that. You're there to advertise your research. You're there to let people know about where you can find your paper. You hope that if you have a handout, you want them to take it home and read it on the plane on the way home. And then call you and say, I think we can write a paper together. That's what you want. That's what you want. Focus on the main points. Your audience is not going to remember the details, so less is actually more, especially in a 12-minute talk plus 3-minute Q&A. You can't give the history of the world in that amount of time. You can't give your whole paper. If you try, you will fail. It will be a disaster. And I think we've all seen people who try to go through too many slides in a too short time. Better to do less than to overwhelm people with a lot of detail. You don't need to give all the background information. They can read your paper if they want a complete literature review. You don't need to defend the validity of your idea. You do that in your dissertation defense, but not at the conference. You don't need to give a whole literature review. Just a few key papers is the main point. You're not there to talk about other people's research, but your research. You need to give short take-home points that they will remember. Don't summarize popular ideas. Don't assume that a critic is familiar with, familiar to you is familiar to everyone else. And also, and this is important, be careful about criticizing other scholars, because they could be sitting in your audience. They will not appreciate you talking about their critical flaw and big, if they're sitting there, question, problems. And think about your audience. In every audience, we have some experts in your specific area, some experts in your general area, and some who know little or nothing. As a speaker, you need to reach all of these people, give them all something that they can take home. So here's the format of a typical conference talk. We will begin with the non-technical, and we'll kind of go in and out like this. Each of our major topics, we will begin by introducing the problem very well. And then we come out to the application, problem application, and then the ending as well. So we try to give something for everybody. This is the depth of the topic, and this is time that we are speaking. Now, you don't have to do exactly this. Sometimes we can begin general and end general. That's the more typical structure. But it's nice to come up in the middle somewhere, too, to connect again with those people who are sleeping. The key point with sleeping people is one guy who's sleeping will influence everybody. It's like a disease. It will just spread through your audience. That's why as a speaker, you're always watching. always watching for the sleepers, because the sleeper could easily bring more with him. The hotel phenomenon. It will just spread through your audience. So don't try to say too much. Use handouts for extra material that you want to say. Have a timing device, especially when you are practicing your talk. Don't practice for the first time at the conference. You need to know how long each slide will take. You can put a little stopwatch. We use an egg timer in my class, and it goes ding, and then we know the time is up. I want students to be very familiar with what 12 minutes feels like, what 3-minute Q&A feels like. Otherwise, we'll just go to 20 minutes, and the chair will kick us out during our key point. We don't want that to happen. And if we practice 12 minutes, we begin to have a feel, almost to the minute, when 12 minutes comes and how long each slide will take. Now, I should also mention that we are responsible for ending on time. We cannot just go on and on into another guy's time. He came all the way across the world for his 12 minutes, and we just can't take his 12 minutes. That's not polite. Also, don't let other people take your 12 minutes. Oh. I have interrupted speakers who are coming before my students before, because I see our time is going. I'll say, excuse me, sir, we need to speak. My student just so embarrassed. I don't want our time to be taken. It's very valuable that we be able to make our full contribution there, and we need to be conscious about our own time as well. Practice. PowerPoint also has a timing function that you can use to see how long each slide will take you. And that if someone interrupts you and takes some of your time, don't think you can immediately go with your normal time and go into someone else's time. You should know in advance what slides you can skip. Because if you don't know that, what will happen? You'll come to the end and you'll skip your implications and results, which is the most important part of your... You'll spend a lot of time on introduction and on method, which is not so critical. And you will cheat your implications and applications. So if you know you're running out of time, know which slides in the middle you can cut, which slides in the beginning you can cut. Don't cut the last ones. That's where your value is. Here's a short conference talk outline that I use in my class for preparing our conference talk. The first one is, the first slide will say the author, the title, and the university on it. Then abstract will give the basic problem and answer. An outline will give the basic talk structure. Then motivation and problem statement, 1 to 2 slides. This is just like the academic paper. We begin our introduction in the same way, right? Why does anyone care about this problem? That's our motivation. And then what problem will we answer? Our problem statement. Related work, very brief. Notice 0 to 1 slides. Sometimes I see people have 20 slides of literature review. What does that leave for our own contribution? It looks like our own contribution is very small compared to the literature that we are citing. Methods, 1 slide, you know, very quickly. Well, it depends on the research, but usually we are here for the results and implications, which are 4 to 6 slides. We will present only the key results and implications, and we will not cover all the results. We will cover some specific results well. We want to be able to make sure that people go home with a clear understanding of our work. If they want to know all of our results, read my paper, right? It's sitting here, you can take it home. Summary, 1 slide. Future work, 1 slide. Why do I have a future work? Well, I hope very much that I can advertise to the next generation of scholar to continue and extend my research. If they extend my research, they have to cite my paper, which includes increases my impact factor, right? I'm trying very hard to interest scholars in continuing. Also, there could be someone who wants to write a paper with me together, co-author. 2 of my students right now are writing papers with people they met at conferences, 1 from Syria, 1 from Jordan. The future work slide can help. It's like fishing. You're looking for someone interested in working with you on another paper in the future. Finally, backup slides. What are the backup slides? Well, my students are always afraid of Q&A, and if we have time today, I'm going to talk about Q&A. But if no one asks questions, what do we do? Here we are at 12 minutes. We have to go to 15, and we say, any questions? 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 Please, please. Don't kill me, don't kill me. Everyone's just there looking at you. It's a long time. And if the audience doesn't ask the questions, what will happen? The chair will ask the question. His question's always terrible. Always terrible. Because he doesn't really plan on asking a question, so he will think, and then he'll ask you something that is just horrible. Just really, really bad. So, to be prepared for this, what you should do is have 3 extra slides with questions that you will probably get asked. That way, if they ask, you can go to that slide. But if no one asks, you can say, one question I frequently get is, chink, ask yourself a question. Answer it. No one still? Okay, not a question. Do your own Q&A. Make sure the show continues. Don't just stay there and slowly die in front of everyone. And then after, summarize and finish. Sometimes for Q&A, by the way, my students will have like a little arrangement. The first question is always the most difficult to get. After first one, second one's easy. But first one, there's always the pause, you know? It takes forever. Questions? You're sitting there, waiting. We have students go together. The other student will sit in the audience and ask the first question. I have a question. Oh, yes, sir. What's your... We know what his question will be. We arrange the first one. After the first one, second one will come. I mean, this is a way that we can cheat a little bit here and make sure that the Q&A can start. After the presentation. If you're using quotes in your speech, here's how we do it in English. You will say, he said, quote, and we go like this, chink, chink. When we do this in English, we are not trying to be cute. This means quotation marks, right? Quote, end quote. We will say those words. He said, quote, da 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 da, end quote. We make the little thing sign with the fingers again. Sometimes we only go like this. We don't say quote, end quote. We just say, he said, again, this means not my words, someone else's words, not picture time, right? be careful criticizing other scholars. I talked about that. PowerPoint is useful compared to, it saves time compared to writing on the board, but sometimes students want to use all of the special features of PowerPoint, the little cute thing. But the problem is, PowerPoint is not actually your friend. And I want to make this an important point here. PowerPoint does not replace you as a speaker. And the more powerful you make PowerPoint, the weaker you become, because you are competing with your PowerPoint for the attention of your audience. You are. So the stronger PowerPoint is, the more people will not look at you. And PowerPoint should not replace you. The speaker is the point. This is why if you watch that movie, An Inconvenient Truth with Al Gore, I don't know if you saw that movie. He uses PowerPoint, but he uses a pointer like this, and every time he says something, he turns his PowerPoint off. Talks on, off. Wonderful. He knows this rule that PowerPoint is fighting him. He doesn't want people looking at the cute picture. He wants them looking at him as the speaker. And I think the reason why people make their PowerPoint so detailed and complicated is that they think that the goal of a speech is only to inform. They think they are only there to give the information. But that is not the goal of the speech. If our only goal in a presentation was to give information, we could save a lot of time today if I emailed you the PowerPoint and we didn't come here at all. That is not our only goal. We also need to make the information interesting. We are also selling the information. We are also applying it. We are creating a feeling. And when we make that link, we can move our audience with us, and they will remember much more. Information is not the only reason why we're there, which is why PowerPoint can't be too powerful. It can't. And you've seen this before, too. Speakers who turn on their PowerPoint, and when the PowerPoint turns on, everybody turns off, right? You've seen it. I've watched it myself in my other classes sometimes. I'll see a speaker turn on the PowerPoint, and the noise of the machine. And I look around the room, everyone. It's amazing. It's just a physical response. I don't even think they know they're doing it. Just the eyelids half closed, the body slouches. Preparing for the sleeping. PowerPoint is dangerous. It's not always your friend. Just keep that in mind, especially at the conference. And also, about PowerPoint, prepare for computer problems. The more technical things you put in your PowerPoint, the more technical problems you may have. Video animation could kill everything. So let's avoid it. I always like to use the light background with the dark words because I never know the lighting of the conference, and this is the safest one. Light background with dark. Dark and light, if there's any light from outside or the sun is shining in, you can't see it. But if we keep light and dark, it's always the safest bet for the... But have a backup on your USB or your MP3 player of your slides or online that you can download if something happens. Another thing is sometimes conferences have no power. Computer dies completely. So we always print out a hard copy of our PowerPoint slides to carry with us. Because even though it's possible to give a speech with no PowerPoint, it's very difficult with no notes at all, right? So at least if we have our own PowerPoint, we can survive if we go to a conference. You can also use your handout, if you have a handout, as like to go through the handout with people if you don't have PowerPoint. Here are some other presentation problems that students sometimes have. What if someone asks a question about an issue you plan to discuss later? It ruins your flow, so just quickly answer the question and go back to your... It ruins your flow, so just quickly answer the question and go back to your original topic. If you skip ahead and then try to go back, it's not going to work well. What if you lose your thought in mid-sentence? Suddenly, gone. Smile. People like people who smile. It's the easiest way to cheat. Even if you do a terrible job, if you smile, people still like you. They do. And I tell students this is the easiest way to get the good feeling with the audience. Smile. I forget to do this sometimes, and I keep reminding myself, always smile, because it creates the goodwill. And then if you smile and you make a mistake, everyone smiles, you laugh, you have a good time. But if you're not smiling and you make a mistake, it's like an earthquake. You have no flexibility built into your talk. So by smiling, you create the good feeling that gives you much more flexibility for any problem that may come. What if you plan to go through your handout page by page, but people are jumping ahead? Well, this is why, oh, by the way, I have a handout today. Remind me to give that to you. I brought one in Chinese, an outline of my talk today. I can give it to you after, yeah. If this is why I don't give out the handout in advance. Because people will open it up and read it and ignore me for 30 minutes and then say, oh, I already know everything. Finish. It's really difficult. So this is the problem with giving out the handout first. I try to give it at the end. At the end is best, and then they can take it home and remember the key points. Your throat dries out. This happens sometimes too. One piece of advice that I've used and my students sometimes use is to put a little piece of tissue paper at the back of your last tooth, and that will create saliva. Actors do that all the time. Try this at home first. I don't want you to die in front of a lot of people. But it's one way to generate the saliva there. I drink lots of water. You see my little Charlie Wong bottle? I take that everywhere. And I fill it up with water, and I drink, and I drink, and I drink. Because I teach a lot every day, so I need the water. Lots of water, you can just keep going. What if someone starts a private conversation while you are speaking? This can be so distracting. But at the same time, I think it's important to understand that when you are speaking, you are responsible for what happens in your room. You must be in control of that. You cannot allow a conversation over here to stop people from listening to your points. And this can be very stressful, I know, to deal with this. But the first thing is, ask any questions. Look at them. Hopefully they'll stop. If not, you can kind of walk close to them and then get really quiet. And then they seem really loud, you know. And then they will stop. Notice your audience and respond to their needs. If the room is hot, turn on the air conditioning. If it's too bright, pull down the shade. You have to be aware of things that are taking your audience's attention away. I know one speaker who went into a room, it was too hot, this is at a conference, too hot, and the windows didn't open. So he took a stone and threw it through the window, broke the window. Now I think that's kind of crazy and extreme, but I admire that he's taking responsibility for the environment of the room. I mean, that shows that he cares, actually, about the audience. Don't do that. Don't. Also, you can distribute copies of your paper at the end of your talk. We print out 25 copies of our paper, and we leave it there for people to take when they leave. Humor. Let's talk a little bit about humor. Do we have to be funny when we speak? The answer is no, we don't. Humor can be useful, certainly. It can help to get the audience's attention. It can help to make people enjoy themselves. It can help to make your point. But it's not necessary. And I think that this is important to understand for students who are always trying to be funny. Key point, if you're not funny, don't try to use humor. It will be painful. I have a student who always begins every speech with a joke, and I always know it's a joke, which means it's not going to work. Whenever someone knows it's a joke, they won't laugh. It's about impossible when you start, whenever you say, let me tell you a joke, you just destroyed the joke. It will never work. It will never work after that. Let me tell you a joke. And then his joke is always not related to his topic, which means it's high risk. He'll say, there's a man and a dog and a boat, and I say, oh, you know, there's no connection there. So if the joke fails, it will be bad. So he always finishes the joke, and then he says, He laughs himself, and we always don't laugh. And then he will try to explain why we must laugh. He'll say, this is funny because you see that, that, and then it makes it much worse. And then he will say, here's another joke. Oh. Never use humor in the beginning of your speech. That's the most difficult time to use humor. You have no connection with your audience. If you're going to use humor, wait for the middle. Wait for the end. Never in the beginning. The audience doesn't know you well enough to know if it's okay to laugh or not. They don't know the relationship with you. So using humor, especially in the beginning, was very unlikely to work. And just remember that the most famous speeches in history used no humor at all. And we remember them to today. It's not necessary to be funny. Not at all. I don't have time today, but there are 9 factors for capturing the attention of our audience. Humor is only one. Only one. And if we don't use it, we can still be great speakers, great presenters. And just remember, too, humor takes practice. If you want to use humor, especially for the different cultural environment, like a conference, you tell a joke that's really funny in Taiwan, and people in Korea will look at you very strangely. It's a different culture, and it took me a long time to understand this in Taiwan. I remember when I first came, and I started teaching, that's 9 years ago, in Jiaoda, I gave a story, and no one laughed. Everyone looked at me. I could hear small birds singing. It was just disaster. Disaster. And humor is cultural. It is. And so you have to learn what works in this culture. If you don't know what works, just don't try. Or use humor that's related to your speech topic. I think that's always the best rule. Because then, even if it's not funny, it still works. It still adds value to your topic. Make sure it's connected. And whatever you do, don't wait for people to laugh. If you tell a joke and no one laughs, just keep talking. When you wait, everyone knows that it was supposed to be funny. All right. I'm moving on here to using PowerPoint at the conferences. Don't write everything on your PowerPoint and then just read it. PowerPoint is supposed to support the speaker, not you support the PowerPoint. PowerPoint can clarify ideas, emphasize key points, show relationships, like in a picture. That's a good function for PowerPoint. Provide visual information to make sure the audience understands your message. Slides should be short. 6 lines of text of slide is enough. 9 is a lot. 12 is unreadable. That's just too much. Use a big type. Let me just show you some font sizes here. 72 point, easy to read, right? 36, 24. 24 is the smallest that really we are comfortable with. When it gets down to 18 and 12, everyone's, you know, squinting and you can't even read it. Especially because the audience is always make sure that the font is big enough. What kind of font should we use? We have 2 major types of font in English language. One is called serif, and one is called sans serif. Serif is an Arabic word, and it means feet. That's what serif means. Sans serif means no feet, literally, no feet. Now, when we say feet, if you look at the times, you see the feet on the bottom of the T and on the end of the T here, at the bottom of the P, that's what we call a serif font. Serif font is 30% faster to read in a book, which is why most books are in serif font. However, when a serif font is projected on the screen, the feet become fuzzy. We don't like it. We like sans serif font for projecting in our PowerPoint. So a sans serif font is like Arial. That's a sans serif font. Here's one. Notice Helvicta, too. This is sans serif font. Notice that Helvicta is easier to read than Times. Also easier than Arial Narrow. Arial Narrow is sans serif, but it's too narrow as well. So, for handouts and take-home material, use the serif font. For projecting on the screen, or using a projector of any kind, use the sans serif, the no feet font. Choosing a color. They say that the most readable color is yellow and black, like a school bus. But that's a little bit crazy for our PowerPoint, so we like the contrast of white and black. Don't put red and green together because 10% of people are colorblind and won't see anything on your screen if you do that. If you use the white and black words, you'll be sure that people will be able to understand even if you have light on your screen. Although you should try to make sure that there's not light on your screen like today. This first row doesn't work, which is great. We can have dark here, light here. Often I go into classrooms and the lights are always this way, which means that there's no way to win, you know. Either everyone's in the dark or everyone's in the light. Don't put everyone in the dark. People sleep in the dark. People sleep in the dark and in the warm. You want light and cold. Lots of light, very cold. That's the teacher's best friend. I always have the 8 o'clock class in Jiaodong. 8 o'clock in the morning. Public speaking, nobody wants to wake up at 8 o'clock. So we use all the weapons we can. Students always come to class with heavy coat. They know I turn on the air conditioning, really cold. Make sure everyone is awake. Let's talk about presenting with charts. We can use charts to show the relationship between things. And often students don't know which chart to use to best show their results. The key point here is to start with your heading of your chart, which should have an action word, a verb in there. The verb should show where we should look in your chart, what key information we should look for. Now, when you should take that verb, when you see the verb, then you can determine which chart to use. If your keyword has the word, if your heading has the word grow, decline, or trend, you should use the line chart. The line chart will show the change over time. So any of these key terms, this is the right chart for you to use. Easy to understand. If you want to compare items at one point, additional tips for the graphs in your PowerPoint, only show one message. Today, I have a 2008, this computer has 2003. I couldn't use my 2008. Fortunately, I also had saved it as a 2003 because I was expecting this kind of thing to happen. It's very possible that this could happen to you. Save in those earlier versions of PowerPoint. If you're not using all the special features, the earlier version's good enough anyway for you. Don't apologize for making errors. This is important. I oftentimes have a student who will make some error in his PowerPoint, English error, for example, and he will stop and he will notice and he will say, "Oh, there's a mistake. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, my English is so poor." Oh. Nobody even noticed it before. And now it became a really big deal. In fact, here's just a good general rule. Never say you're sorry. Never. When you're speaking. Students come up a lot and they always want to be so humble. And they will say, "I don't know what I'm going to say. I'm not really prepared. My English is poor. Please don't listen to me. Thank you." I'm just why you would kill yourself before you have a chance. But of course we will listen to nothing you say after that. We don't believe you because you don't believe you. Never say you're sorry for anything that happens in your presentation. Just keep going. Be as smooth as you can. Buy a wireless pointer and mouse. I'm not selling these, but they're wonderful. This little thing right here. It only has the four buttons. I love it. I can go forward. Okay, Glenn, it's not working. Forward, backward, or laser pointer, or blank screen. Only four buttons. I like this one particularly because the last one I had was like a TV remote control. So complicated to use it. And I could just, simple is better. And this is cheap, super cheap. I love that too. And you can put the little pointer in the back, take it everywhere. And then if you get used to yours, then you can automatically change it without thinking. But if every time you go to a conference, you have to use theirs, who knows what kind of crazy device they have. It's better to carry your own with you that you're used to, and then you don't have to think about it when you're changing your slides. The last thing about your PowerPoint, you should have a URL with your website address on there so that people can contact you later if they want to write a paper with you, or if they want to work with you on a research project. Make sure you always have your contact info. If your paper is not online, put it online before the conference so people can look you up and keep in contact with you. Let me talk about handling Q&A for a few minutes. We've talked about that a little bit before. Students are always afraid about the Q&A part because we can't really prepare for it. We don't know exactly what they'll say. And they have the wrong idea that a question is an attack on them. They think if someone's asking them a question, someone's trying to kill them. And that may be true, but usually not. Usually it is a compliment to you to get a question, so you should be willing to accept it. In fact, questions have a number of benefits. They get attention. They create interest, they get feedback from the audience that you can use. They make your points easy to remember. They get the audience to interact with each other. They promote new thoughts in you and the audience. Sometimes the Q&A can be the most valuable part of the speech. And I think that this is a cultural difference too between Taiwan and international conferences, like in America. In America, when we get a question, we think it's a good thing, but in Taiwan, no one asks me questions. I mean, really, almost never. I've given speeches now, in the last 9 months, I've presented 67 different universities around Taiwan. I'm on the train 3 times every week, just all over. And I probably have gotten, maybe 10 questions total in all of that time. Now, they ask a lot of questions, but they always ask me during the bathroom break, or after, or during the lunch break. You know, I get the questions, and I understand, that's the culture here. There's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. I think that's okay. But I just want to prepare you for the fact that when you go to the conference, that will not always happen. People will ask you questions. They will. And they're not necessarily trying to attack you. It's just that this is the culture. You know, people do ask questions in front of a large audience. Before the presentation, how can you prepare for Q&A? Tell your ideas to a critical friend. You know, ask him to criticize and ask him to tell you what he thinks will be your weakness or what he thinks the questions will be. Bring a list of references, you know, for the key papers in your back pocket. Then if someone challenges you, you can bring out the paper and tell him the specific study, because otherwise it's difficult to say, I remember something about that, and I think it was, I can't remember that. So at least if you have the backup, hard copy with you, then you can look it up quickly if you need to. Take notes of questions and suggestions that people give you. Don't be afraid to say you don't know the answer to a particular question. Just say you'll research it for them, you'll get back to them. But if you say you'll get back to them, really do get back to them. Because he'll be there next year at the same conference looking for you. He'll say, you didn't answer my question. So you can't avoid him forever. Especially because your domain is very small. Very small. You're definitely going to meet him again. You can also save several slides to answer expected questions. The backup slides we already talked about before. Remember that at the end of your presentation, you actually have two endings. One before Q&A and one after Q&A. We always want to leave our audience on a high note. And when we end after Q&A, sometimes it's very weak. It's, any more questions? No? Are you sure? Okay, bye-bye. I mean, it's just poor. So what you want to do is have a clear, strong ending. we summarize again and then end strong. You know, we can say, here's what we know, A, B, C, thank you, bye-bye, you know, bring it back to an ending close. So we have two close, one before Q&A, one after Q&A. After the presentation, you can stay behind too. People will sometimes ask you their real question then, and sometimes that's really the best questions. So don't just start running away as soon as you finish. Kind of hang around outside for a few minutes and then people can come and meet you. Here are 12 ways to encourage questions in your presentation. Again, we like presentations. They're a compliment. They're an honor for us. We want to get people thinking of questions before the end. If the first time they think of a question is at the end of the speech, probably won't be any questions. So we could, for example, announce the question session in a very open conversational way. Look like we want questions. Any questions? Smile. Talk. Don't run away. Second, you can design questions into your content, like into your title. Why knowledge management? Why now? Into your opening. What is the biggest problem facing researchers today? If you're asking them questions, they're thinking with you. They're interacting. They're more likely to ask you. My presentation is about four key questions. Considering these facts, how can we not act? You can ask a question, pause, then give the answer. That gets them thinking. You can bring up questions you have been asked by other audiences. You can tell the audience at the beginning there's a Q&A. Provide a seating arrangement where people can see each other. This is a really big one. You know, we're in the classroom style right now, and it's very unlikely we will get many questions in this kind of class because people can't see each other. If you can see each other, if the tables are facing each other in some way, much greater interaction. That's why those UK classrooms with the circles on top of each other are so interactive. Everyone's shouting at each other and the teacher who's like in a hole. It's like very, very interactive style there because everyone can see everybody all the time. You can list questions in the presentation announcement or brochure. You can provide a whiteboard for people to write down. You can pass out paper for people to write down their question and then give it to you. That's a good way, because then if you get a really angry, nasty question, you can just read a different question. No one knows. You can survive. Don't ask for feedback and then start to run away. You know, look like you want them. Or you could ask for someone to arrange to ask the first question during the Q&A session, like your friend. Here's maybe the best one. Think to yourself what question you hope nobody will ask you and prepare for that question. And then you're more confident about all of them because you know the worst. You're ready for the worst. Why do people ask questions? I want to spend a few moments on this because it's important to understand that not everyone who asks questions has a pure heart. Some people who ask questions have dirty motivations, and in some cases, you don't have to answer every question. I want to be really clear on this. You don't have to stay there fighting a battle that you can never win. So let's take a look at why people ask questions. Number one, and the best one, is because they want to know the answer, right? Of course you should try to answer that question. He really wants to know, and you want to tell him. This is the most common one. Second, because they want to make a point. They want to make their point to the rest of the audience. Again, I'm okay with that. Thank you for your point. That's fine. To impress the audience, they want to show off what they know. That's, again, a motivation often for questions. Again, I'm okay with that. You're very smart. Thank you. You know, I'm okay. To see if you know the answer. Now we're getting a little bit tougher. He knows. He wants to see if you know. All right? He's testing you. You have no choice but to try to answer this one. If you're wrong, well, maybe he can correct you. You can still survive. To see how you handle questions and stress. How he's pushing you to see if he can make you sweat. To see if he can actually make you nervous. This is very stressful for first-time speakers, particularly for any speaker, but especially for the first-time speakers. Again, you're probably going to have to go ahead and try to do your best and answer it. Smile cheerfully the whole time. The smile will become kind of plastic after a while. To attack your methodology. Now it becomes much more difficult because he's attacking the fundamentals of your paper. In this case, It's hard to deal with methodology issues very quickly. You may want to say, that's a very interesting question, sir. I would love to talk to you about it after. Never be afraid to say, talk to you later. Don't make a fool of yourself in front of this group of people who just listened to you and were impressed by you. This is not the place for a long discussion. You only have 3 minutes. There's no way that you can really get into it enough. You could say, see me after. Finally, we get into the two that you should not answer. If someone wants to make you look bad, if, for example, they're competing for a job, or competing for a project, or competing for funding, or just a bad person, I don't know why. There's no way to win here. You answer, and he'll keep coming back, and keep coming back. And the only way he can win is if you lose. So there's just not a good way out, and I hate to see PhD students get into this kind of thing. Much better to just say, see me after for this kind of thing. Don't get into a war here. Sometimes their questions are actually a personal attack. I have had this myself, and it is no fun. I was doing a speech in Kaohsiung, I won't name the place, last year, and I was giving my speech about technical writing for publication, my research on why papers are rejected by international journals. And there was an older foreign teacher who came from journals. And there was an older foreign teacher who came in and sat in the back, which always gives a little alarm for me because I think his English is probably very good. I wouldn't know why he's there. And he immediately, I mean from the first sentence, I've given this speech many times, from the first sentence, he just says, stupid. He kept saying, again and again, for 2 hours, and I kept thinking, should I answer? And I thought, what can I say? No, I'm not stupid. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. I don't know how I can win. I don't know how we can possibly resolve that. How can I answer that kind of question with any kind of good result? Or in the end, it was just a losing question. There was no way to win with that kind of question. So I just ignored it for 2 hours. And it was very, very, very painful. It was hard. I felt like the speech was going badly. I felt like my rhythm was off. I felt like everything was bad. But at the end, I did the evaluation of the speech. It was the best evaluation I ever got. The audience appreciated that I had ignored this guy. They appreciated that I had just continued on. And it did not hurt my presentation at all. So in this kind of situation, I would just suggest you ignore it if it's really that bad. If it's really a personal attack, my great hope is that you never have this experience. I hope most of the questions are more toward this side than that side. But I want to make you aware that there is a spectrum here of motivation that you may have when you receive questions. Don't let an interesting but unrelated question start you on a new speech. I know that this is interesting for you, but you only have 3 minutes for Q&A, and you shouldn't use all of that 3 minutes for one question and then go into someone else's time. Don't let your presentation time continue thinking the Q&A time is extra time for your speech. And consider questions an honor. Good speeches make good questions. Boring speeches put people to sleep and make them leave. So the fact that they were awake and remembered what you said is a compliment. Here's a three-step template for answering Q&A. First, listen to the whole question before you answer it. Sometimes the speaker will take a long time to get to his real point, and you have to listen. Second, thank the person for asking the question, even if you're not thankful. lie. See? And then follow the template below. Repeat the question so everyone can hear, respond to the question, and then review. Does that answer your question? Go back to the questioner. If the question is angry or personal, do not review. Just don't look at it again. Answer and look away. Any other questions over here? If you keep going back, you're just going to go into a negative situation. Here are some additional tips. Ask people to stand up when they ask the question. It will make them, you know, more responsible for what they say and also let people hear what they have to say as well. What if you don't know the answer? Of course, you can admit that you don't know the answer, but you can't do that every time. You can't just say, I don't know. So what are some other things you can do if you don't know the answer? Well, I always tell my students to suggest their professor. Your professor is sitting there. He gave you this topic. Let him help you. say, my professor has studied this a lot, professor. Delay, say, that's a good question. While you are thinking. Ask a question. Could you clarify what you mean? Sometimes when he asks the question again, it's much easier. Sometimes when he repeats the question, it's a lot better than the first one. Admit you don't know it, but we'll research it for them. Of course, that's always a good option. You could repeat the question in a slightly different way. Maybe the way you repeat the question is easier for you to answer. So actually, you changed the questions, which you did, just a little bit. And that's okay, you see this all the time at conferences. When they repeat, they will change it. Or sometimes they just answer a different question. You know, that happens too. I've seen that frequently, where the questioner will say, can you talk about dogs? And the speaker, yes, dogs are wonderful animals that hate cats. Cats! And they start talking about and most of the time, I will look around at the audience, and no one notices. They're nodding their head. It seems to work. If you still don't have a good answer after all of this, then you can say, let's talk after my talk. I mean, that's always appropriate, too. What if you can think of nothing to say? Don't just stand there and slowly die painfully. Smile. Start to tell a story. I've seen that done before. It has to be related in some way. While you're telling a short story, sometimes you can think about the answer. You can also change the topic of the question to something that you know about. Here's a key one. What if you don't understand the question because of the speaker's poor English? Especially at international conferences, this can be a problem. And I'll give you the example of one of my PhD students recently at a conference. There was, at the end of the speech, there was a Japanese gentleman, who raised his hand and asked a question, and basically the question sounded like this, ha-cha-cha-ha-cha-cha-ha. Just like that. And my student said, sorry, what? He says, cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. My student said, again, cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. And this was like ping-pong. For a while, and then, and I've been sitting there thinking, oh, please, please, someone stop it. The chair tries to be helpful and says, the chair says, I think he means, and the Japanese guy, chom, chom, chom. And then someone else in the audience said, maybe he means. And it was like English guessing game. 5 minutes. It was so painful. And the poor Japanese guy, his face got red and he just ran out. And I told my student later, I said, listen, next time that happens, just answer any question and keep going. Because, you know, the questioner will be so thankful. He will find you later and write down his question and you can talk about it together. This is not the place for the English guessing game. You just come up with anything to end and finish. Right now I'm teaching a class in the science part in Hsinchu, and I have a student from India, an engineer. He's a very nice guy. And his boss has sent him because he hopes that after taking my class, he will be able to understand what this engineer is saying. But I don't think I have helped at all, because every class, he's a great guy, I like him, he'll raise his hand. Question, and I always think, no, no. And I'll say, yes, and he'll say, habidi, 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 habidi. And I just always say, good point, thank you. Because I do not know what he's saying. I have no idea if it's even English. And I'm concerned about just ruining the speech and the class. So in this kind of situation with English, just move on. Don't let that destroy this poor questioner and your speech by becoming something that it shouldn't be. If it's important, he will find you later. Write it down, and you can write an answer. You can work it out. What if someone keeps interrupting you while you are speaking? This is very stressful. Very stressful. What can you do? He keeps coming in with loud comments all the time. In the beginning, first thing you should do, if it's really short, just answer and keep speaking. But if it keeps going on, you may have to say, sir, can you please wait for the question period? If it continues on after that, look at the chair. This is the chair's job. But the chair usually is sleeping. I don't know. Not helpful. So if the chair doesn't save you, then the problem with this kind of interruption is that the audience doesn't know that this is a problem for you. Because you keep answering him, so the audience thinks it's okay. So the audience doesn't help you, doesn't give the strong social pressure to the questioner. So what you need to do, and this is very hard to do, but in some instances you have to say, please sir, allow me to finish my talk, and then just keep going without looking at him. What will happen? The audience now realizes that you have problems and that this guy's giving you problems, and they will turn like this. And they will give some little noises. And then he will crouch down. So let the audience help you with the social pressure. But you have to make a strong statement first. Otherwise, they don't know. They don't know that it's a problem. Remain after your presentation session. Again, sometimes your best feedback comes then. You get a lot of questions as well. Okay. For more information about this, I wrote a handout, which I have for you today, also on PDF format on my website. I have written a lot of stuff in Chinese about technical writing and some about conference presentation. It's available no charge at my site. You can download it, as well as my slides. I have a lot of PowerPoint slides that I've done on different speeches. You can find editing.tw. As the name suggests, we modify over 20